grateful, God, to know that in Jesus there is peace. Most importantly, peace with you. Because of our sin, we fall short of your glory and are not at peace with you. But through the righteousness of Jesus Christ, we have an offer of ultimate peace with you in this moment and with you forever. And so, God, we thank you for the peace of Christmas and knowing, God, that it's not just the peace of that we might have in various moments of Christmas, in various nights by the fire or whatever other kind of romanticized things we think about peace, God, that what you offer is so much more. So much more and so much deeper. And so, God, we give you praise and honor, thanksgiving for peace. We pray, God, that not just today, but throughout this Christmas season, we are able to focus on the reality of peace in Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Let's stand and worship him together, singing a couple of classic Christmas hymns.
Come and worship.
that you have come, that you have rescued us from sin and death and the grave. Lord, we thank you for the peace that you brought when you came as a baby. Lord, I pray that you would continue to speak to our hearts, speak to our minds, that we would continue to expect you to move in our hearts and lives as we open your word. Lord, I pray over this offering. I pray that as we give, that we would recognize that we are giving from what you have already blessed us with. Lord, I pray that you would use this offering, that you would receive it, that you would bless it, and so that it would go forth and advance the gospel and further your kingdom. Lord, we love you. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. together as the body of Christ here at Glen Hope, we are entering into a season of remembering the first advent, the first coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. But as the people of God, we remember it in light of his promised second coming. There is a second advent coming. Hear the words of the Lord Jesus as recorded by the gospel writer Mark. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great glory and great power. He'll send out his angels to gather his elect from the very ends of the earth. As you and I pray today, we're going to pray for ourselves that in this time of Advent, there would be a new awakening in us by the Spirit of God of being on mission for the Lord Jesus. And we pray also for our ministries, for the church plant, and we'll also be praying for Saturday for our church outreach, that it would be a time where the kindness of the Lord would be experienced by our community. So pray with me if you will. Father, it is because of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is our great high priest, that we gather here and we come before you. We thank you, yes, with great thanksgiving, that the first advent has happened. The Lord Jesus came and he sought the lost. He came to seek and to save the lost. And so we thank you that we are among that group. We pray for any of us here that do not yet know a new spiritual birth from heaven, that this would be a day. Pray for the word spoken as Pastor Lewis speaks. We pray that it would be anointed with power, that we might hear from you, that these would be the word of the Lord to us in these days. And so, Lord Jesus, grant by your Spirit a new awakening in us, that we'll be a people who see ourselves on mission with you, and that that mission is the greatest mission. It is our call. It is your command. It is the promise that you will come again. Oh, Lord Jesus, thank you that we can ask for your Spirit to be with us, to shape us, to change us, so that we, too, are a people mighty in word and deed for the Lord. We pray for great things in this place. Pray for our church plant. We pray for Juan and Maribel as they lead. We pray that there would be many who would be coming into that church. And there would be great growth, great discipleship, great help. We pray for great hope to come to many who are Spanish-speaking folk in this day. And we pray for Saturday as was set for a community outreach. We pray that it would be attended by and led by your present Spirit. We pray there'd be great kindness shown to our community, and that they would receive it that way. They would know the kindness of the Lord from the time spent with Christmas Fest. So, Lord Jesus, grant us that we would be people on mission with you, empowered by your Spirit, seeing the mighty acts of God, many saved, many brought into the kingdom. So we ask for great things, because we believe your name, Lord Jesus, is great. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Joel. So today, my friends, we are starting our Christmas series, and I got a whole lot more stuff up here than I normally do, so I'm going to do my best to work around and through this today. Now, you may recall several years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, we did a Christmas series on the songs of Christmas, and we're doing that again this year, where we take a look at some of the Christmas songs that we have been singing for years. And we want to take a look at the story behind these songs, but most importantly, the scripture behind these songs, the theology that is present in these songs. Because as we look at these hymns that we'll be, shooting from, if you will, they're not just songs that the hymn writers just kind of picked out of the air. They are written as a result of meditating on and living in the scriptures of God, particularly thinking about the coming of Jesus, the advent of Jesus. And as Brother Joel just prayed, and as we have sung, and as we will continue to sing, and as we practice with the Advent lighting week after week, it's not just about his initial coming as a baby, not just about that initial time that he took on flesh and came, but always at Christmas, we ought to be pointed to his return, his second coming. And we'll see that. Maybe you don't see that explicitly in every song, but in most Christmas songs, that's there, and it's there for us to see and hold on to. And so that's what we'll be doing over the next few weeks. And hopefully it will help us all set our hearts on the Christmas season. Today's song is Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus. And also you'll note each week that either maybe it's going to be during the service like it was today, but also then as our response time, we're going to sing the song. We're going to sing the song during our response time. Maybe it'll be for the first time during that service, but sometimes it might be the second time that it is a part of what we do. And the idea with that is that having had some teaching on it, having dug into what the writer was getting at and the scriptures that were inspiring the writer of that hymn, we might sing it a little bit differently than we normally do. We might hone in a little bit more on what it means to us individually. And so, this is not scripture. It's based on scripture, but kind of like we do week after week, we get to this point and we read the scripture for the day. Today, we're going to read the hymn for the day. Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. From our fears and sins release us. Let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art. Dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king. Born to reign in us forever, now thy gracious kingdom bring. By thine own eternal spirit, rule in all our hearts alone. By thine all-sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne. Let's pray. Father, it is our prayer today that the scriptures that this song is based on, that it comes from, will work in our hearts and our minds to transform some that may be hearing them today, to edify many of who will be hearing it today. We pray, God, that in all of us, our hearts and minds are turned to you. Our hearts and minds are turned to this long-expected Jesus. I pray, God, that we would understand the scriptures behind this song and what it is that you would have for us to apply in our lives in this time that we spend here together today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. So one of the things that we'll do is kind of give you some of the story behind the song. That's not the big idea of what we're doing. The big idea is to get into the scriptures. But this song was written by one of the most prolific hymn writers there is, in Charles Wesley. Charles Wesley published over 4,500 hymns in his time. He lived in the 1700s. And so this was one of over 4,500 hymns that he published then. He and his brother John Wesley were leaders of the Methodist movement throughout England and got into the United States during the colonial times as well. A couple of other familiar hymns, there are many, but a couple to point out to you that Charles Wesley wrote, "Hark the Herald Angels Sing, Christ the Lord is Risen Today." Now, he wrote "Come Thou Long Expected Jesus," or at least it was published in 1744, and there's so interesting, the hymn book that I have here that I think used to be here has Isaiah 61:1. You know, sometimes in the hymn books they have a scripture passage just under the title that kind of gives some indication that this is what what the song is based on. And so there's some people that think that, but most of what you read says that he was meditating on Haggai chapter 2, verse 7. I would submit that Charles Wesley, and you'll see as we go through this, was meditating on just about the whole Bible as he wrote this song, because there's a million different references here. There's almost every half line in the scriptures is coming from a different scripture passage. This song is almost a theology textbook just in these two little, what do we call those, stanzas? Stanzas, yes. Two little stanzas that we see here. You cover so much of theology. And so that's what we're going to spend most of our time doing. So let's take a look now and kind of break this down. Come, thou long expected Jesus is the opening line of this song, and it is rooted deeply in Scripture and has deep meaning to Christians today and forever, followers of God today and forever, because you go all the way back. I think Charles Wesley had to be thinking of this as he wrote that first line, that opening, those opening few words, "Come, thou long expected Jesus." Wouldn't he have to go back to Genesis chapter 3? Wouldn't he have to go back to the Garden of Eden where Adam and Eve sinned and they had this whole interaction with God, and then God brought forth the judgment and the punishment that would be on them and on the earth to come as a result of the sin, as a result of the nature then of the fallen world that became a part of it. And in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, the scripture says, "And I will cause," this is God talking, "I will cause hostility between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel." And so this is that judgment on Satan, on the serpent, who we understand to represent Satan, the enemy. And so there in chapter 3 is this idea that Jesus, the offspring of the woman, is going to strike the head of the enemy, is going to kill him, is going to destroy him and his effects, going to destroy him and his effects on the fallen world that come as a result of sin. And so this is something that has been expected. This is something that Charles Wesley had to have in mind when he wrote, "Come, thou long expected Jesus." And it has been expected throughout the Old Testament, throughout the ages of the Old Testament. They were looking for that first coming. And now throughout the ages, we sing that same refrain, "Come, thou long expected Jesus." But you can see, just kind of going back, starting in Genesis chapter 3, which we just read, and then Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14 says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel." And so Isaiah the prophet shows us something of this idea of a come, a long-expected Jesus, that people were expecting him to come. Chapter 9 of Isaiah, he says, more, he gives more prophecy, for a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness from then on and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. And then in Micah chapter 5, starting in verse 2, "But as for you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you one will go forth for me to be ruler in Israel. His goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity. Therefore he will give them up until the time when she who is in labor has borne a child. Then the remainder of his brethren will return to the sons of Israel. And he will arise and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they will remain. Because at that time he will be great to the ends of the earth. This one will be our peace." And so you can see throughout the Old Testament, these are just a couple of examples, but throughout the Old Testament, there's this idea of a long-expected Jesus, a long-expected Messiah. And not just this idea that he would come, but a longing, come, come, Lord Jesus, come, Messiah, is what you see throughout thousands of years in the Old Testament. Come, thou long-expected Jesus. And that's that same expectancy then as we flip our minds towards the second coming that we have. We have that same longing for Jesus to return, because we know that with his return, it's better. With his return, we see the fruition of what Isaiah and Micah are speaking of what the people, frankly, in Jesus' day, of what they were looking for. They were looking for a Messiah to establish a government. You'd probably say that many Jewish people today are still looking for that, as they have rejected Jesus as that Messiah. But they were looking for someone to establish this government. But what the scripture is teaching us is that on his second return, on his second coming, that is when he establishes this government, establishes his authority, establishes peace forevermore in his new heaven and his new earth. And so these are the things that go with this idea of come, thou long expected Jesus. But we want to establish the point that for thousands of years in the Old Testament, he was expected. He was expected. And now, for thousands to this point more, we continue to expect him with his return. So, come, thou long expected Jesus. Then he strikes on this idea of born. Born. You see several references in the song. Born to set thy people free. Born thy people to deliver. Born a child and yet a king. Born to reign in us forever. And so he hits on this idea of Jesus being born, and then the particulars of why he is born. But it's important for us to hit first just that one simple idea that he was born. That it's not just some mystical thought, not just some idea that he really didn't step out of heaven, but the reality is that he was born. It was prophesied that he would be born, that a baby would be born to a virgin. And then Luke chapter 2 confirms this for us. As you read in Luke chapter 2, you see that Jesus is born. And then throughout the scriptures of the New Testament, we get this idea that he took on flesh. As we studied in John, when we studied the Gospel of John, John chapter 1 verse 14 tells us that the Word became flesh. And so very much we understand that Charles Wesley is thinking of these things, thinking of these various scriptures when he says that he's born. He's born. And then we start digging into why he's born. Why is he born? He's born to set thy people free from our sins and sins, from our fears and sins releases. And so part one of why he's born, to set his people free. In Isaiah chapter 61, which is what the hymn book has, is some of the inspiration for the song. The scripture says, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the afflicted. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty, freedom, to captives, and freedom to prisoners." And so we see very much this idea that he's born to set people free, because people indeed are captive. John chapter 8, verses 34 through 36, Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is the slave of sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The Son does remain forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." And so what we understand here is that pointedly, the New Testament clarifies for us, as we read in John, that what we need to be set free from, what we are held captive by, is our sin. That's the idea. Now, as people are reading Isaiah and trying to understand what that really means, as Jesus came the first time, I think it's understandable that they could wrestle with, is this a spiritual thing or is this a physical thing? And how many of them were thinking that it was a physical thing, because Israel as a nation was captive, if you will, to Roman government at the time. They were under the control of the Roman government. And so people would have a very short-sighted view of understanding what Isaiah was getting at here and what the true purpose of Jesus setting captives free was. And so they were looking for a very, very near solution to this prophecy, a very, very, very near understanding and fulfillment of this prophecy. But what the New Testament helps us to understand and gives us clarity on is that very much more importantly is being set free from captivity to sin. We'll talk more about that in just a little bit. But that's what's in mind here, and that's what Charles Wesley understands, right? Set thy people free from our fears and sins, release us. And so the idea is that Jesus sets us free from our sins, released from our sins when we surrender to follow him. Because remember, the wages of sin is death. And so that's what we're bound to. That's what we're held captive to until we're set free through the propitiation of Jesus Christ, through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and surrendering to that, then we're set free. We're no longer held captive to that. Now, one of the great benefits then is we're also set free from fears and anxieties and worries. We study about that and we talk about that. And that's some of the things that Charles Wesley has in mind as he writes here. That not only are we set free from the penalty for our sin, but then all the fear and anxiety that comes along with that and comes along with living in a fallen world. Jesus sets us free from that fear. And wouldn't it be a good thing at Christmas time? I think it's a good thing anytime. But isn't it a good thing to think about being set free from your fears and your worries and your anxieties at Christmas time? This is good to think about now. And it's good to think about every day, But that's what he sets us free from. And ultimately, we understand with his second coming, his second advent, that we will be set free for eternity from any fears and anxieties and worries, because there will be no more sin. There will be no more fallen world. He then says, born to reign in us forever. Doesn't follow right there in the song, but that's the next thing we're going to talk about. Born to reign in us forever. And so another reason he was born is to reign in us forever. Luke chapter 1, verses 31 through 33. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 18 through 23, prayer that Paul is praying as he writes here. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened, so that you will know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the surpassing greatness of his power toward us who believe. These are in accordance with the working of the strength of his might, which he brought about in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things in subjection under his feet and gave him his head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The scripture is clear, as Charles Wesley understands, that Jesus is born to reign in us forever, born to reign in us forever. And he reigns over all, whether they acknowledge it or not. The beautiful thing about a relationship with Jesus is that when we acknowledge that he reigns over us, when we live our lives in true and full surrender and acknowledgement of his authority over us, then life is as it ought to be in a fallen world. But it points us to the life that will be in his established new heaven and earth. And so we look ahead to that, even as we live in as much of it as we can in this fallen world. But he reigns. He reigns forever. He is born a child and yet a king. And that works right along with this idea that he reigns forever. Because when he's born, and we see the different pictures and understand the scriptural pictures of a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths, and we see artist renditions of this baby Jesus, and we make poetry and songs about this baby Jesus. No crying he makes, and he's the little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. And all that is true. But don't you miss that he is king. Don't miss that in this picture of little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay is Lord Jesus. Don't miss that he is born a child, but he's still the king. Because the scripture, you'll recall, Charles Wesley has to be thinking, he's thinking of, I just imagine his mind just parading all around the scripture. And in this, he's thinking, Philippians 2 tells me that he didn't equate equality with God as something to be grasped, something to be held onto, but he emptied himself. You see, he was the king already. For eternity, he's been king. And that did not go away when he became a child. He was still the king, although he submitted and surrendered some portion of that authority while he was on this earth. He was still king. He was born to deliver. his people, born to deliver. John 14, 6 says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. A big part of his role, a big part of his being born is to deliver those who are his to the Father. He delivers us. And we don't want to miss that. What a great gift. As we think about Christmas, we think about the gifts of Christmas, we think about being delivered to the Father. It's a gift for us. And perhaps we could even think of being presented to the Father as an offering. Our lives as an offering, a sweet, fragrant aroma to the Lord, our lives and our worship. What else do we see? We'll move on from the born. But my goodness, just this idea of born and all the reasons that Jesus is born gives you something of the fullness of theology and the fullness of Scripture that Charles Wesley must have been considering as he wrote this psalm. But then he talks about this hope of all the earth, desire of every nation. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art. Certainly, as we think about the advent of Jesus, the coming of Jesus, the birth of Jesus, this idea that he is hope of all the earth is important for us, important for people to get. And that as well is not a new idea. It's not a New Testament idea only. It's in the New Testament. But that goes all the way back to Genesis as well. Genesis chapter 12, the Abrahamic covenant that you see that God makes with Abraham. And God says to Abraham, I'm going to bless you, yes, but you and through your seed are going to be a blessing to all the nations, a blessing to all the earth. What we understand is that through Abraham's seed, and ultimately who comes through that? Jesus. Jesus ultimately comes and lives out this fruition of being a blessing to all the earth. And so he is the blessing and he is the hope of all the earth. And then this desire of every nation. Here's where Haggai 2:7 comes in. Haggai chapter 2, verse 7 says, I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come, and I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. And so, as I said to you earlier, this is what some people believe, and maybe Charles Wesley must have told some people this. Maybe it's in writing somewhere. I'm not quite sure. But there's this thought that he was meditating on Haggai 2:7 when he wrote this song again. I think he was meditating on a whole lot more than Haggai 2:7. But this phrase, desire of all, desire of every nation as it comes and come thou long expected Jesus. This showed up in one of the other songs we sang this morning. Did you pick up on that? Put the music people on the spot. But that same phrase, I think it was in the second one we did, showed up this morning. And so, and that's another thing to get, is that you see a bunch of, you see repeated themes in Christmas songs and such rich and deep theology. And it's a beautiful time of year to be singing these songs and picking up on that deep meaning and theology. But the desire of every nation is Jesus. He is what every nation desires. And when you think nation here, yes, you can think nation corporately, United States, Canada, England, Russia, China, right? You can think that way, that he is what every nation desires in that sense. But you can also think nation in terms of ethnos, ethnicity, people. He is what all people desire. He is what all nations desire. And so as we work through this and think about what Haggai must have been meaning and what Charles Wesley is getting at is something of the fullness of who Jesus is. as he is the desire of every nation. And that is a correct understanding of what is said in Haggai 2:7, the desire of all nations shall come. That's pointing to an idea that Jesus, perhaps you might say a name for Jesus, is the desire of all nations, okay? That he will come, but he is that desire. And so even if people don't know it, he is what they desire. Even if nations as a body don't know it, he is what they desire. And as I've been thinking about this, I think you can, maybe I'm oversimplifying it, but for the sake of our time together today, you can boil it down, I think, to two things. People, ethnos, ethnicities, human beings, and nations either desire peace or power. They desire peace or power, however it comes out. Some desire peace. And some understand that ultimately peace only comes through Jesus. Some people in the world understand that peace ultimately only comes through Jesus. Other people in the world desire peace, but they're going at it in all kinds of ways, human efforts. And that's not bad necessarily, but ultimately it won't succeed because we know that the ultimate giver of peace is the Prince of Peace himself, Jesus. And so, yes, he is the desire of the nations when it comes to thinking about peace. People desire peace, but most people don't know and understand that it comes only through Jesus. And that's part of the heartbeat of what we want to get and understand as believers, as followers of Jesus, is that our message has to be, hey, you're looking for peace? That's admirable. That's good. You're working for peace in the world. That's admirable and good. The ultimate way that you do that is to tell people about Jesus, the Prince of Peace, because he will bring it. So people either want peace or they want power. They want power. They say, the heck with peace. I'll give you peace when I get power. Okay. My ideas are best. My nation's, my government's ideas are best. And when I get power and authority, then we'll have some semblance of peace. But people want power. Nations want power. And what we have understood throughout the scriptures we've read today, Isaiah particularly, but then Ephesians as well. So Old Testament and New Testament, we learn that all authority will rest on him, that his government will be established. All things are subjected to him and put under his feet, if you will, under his authority. That sounds like power, right? That sounds like power. That's the desire of all the nations. People want that power, but they want it for themselves. They don't want it for Jesus. And so, whether it's a right understanding or a distorted understanding, Jesus is the desire of all nations. And the characteristics of Jesus, the things Jesus brings, peace and power, that's what all people want in one form or the other. But what we understand, most of us here, I think, understand, and hopefully what we get better at understanding and living out, is that it's the peace of Jesus and the power of Jesus. That's the perspective from which we want to live our lives and live in this world that has it so distorted. But we have to be the ones that are giving that idea and that truth. And so, as we wrap it up and consider the final question of why does it matter to us? Why do the ideas in this song matter to us? The ideas in this song that represent so much scripture, why does it matter to us? We've already gotten at some of why it matters. But we'll sum it up and finish it up this way. Every single person is either captive or has been captive. Every single human being, every single person here is either captive to sin right now, or you have been captive to your sin. That's who we are, because we're born that way. We're born with this sin DNA that has been passed on to us through our parents, Adam and Eve. You're either free or you need to be set free. You're free because you've understood that, hey, I was captive to my sin. There's nothing I can do about it. Only Jesus can set me free from that. You acknowledge that. You surrender to that. You surrendered your life to Jesus. You surrendered your captivity to Jesus. You surrendered your captivity to sin to Jesus. And so now you're free. Or maybe you're still captive and you need to be set free. If you are free today, if you used to be captive and you recognize that, here's the message for Christmas. Here's the message from this song that you want to be thinking about. As you think about come thou long expected Jesus, meditate on, pray on, and celebrate the fact that you have been set free. And let that inform your worship. Let that inform your living as you live your life with this biblical perspective of who you were, but who Jesus has now made you. And so this informs your living. It informs your thinking. It informs every part of who you are. Remember who you used to be. If you're not a follower of Jesus, you're captive to sin. You're not free. And chances are, you're not really thinking about yourself that way. Chances are, you're not really thinking that. Chances are, you didn't come in here today thinking, I'm a captive to my sin. I'm in captivity here. Or maybe you're watching this online sometime later and you're thinking, what? I'm not captive to, I'm not a follower of Jesus, but I'm not captive to anything. I do what I want to do. I live a happy life. I'm good. And you see, and that's the thing about being captive to sin. It ruins your senses. You're blind. You can't see. You can't see that you're a captive to sin and you're a captive to the enemy. You can't see it. Because the scripture tells us that you're dead. You're spiritually dead. And what can a dead man see? Dead man can't see anything, can he? He's dead. And so you need help. And so you've come in here today and you're spiritually dead, blind, captive. You don't even know it, but hear me saying this, that you are indeed captive. Over in 2 Timothy chapter 2, start around verse 24, the Lord's bondservant must not be quarrelsome, but be kind to all, skillful in teaching, patient when wronged, with gentleness correcting those who are in opposition, if perhaps God may grant them repentance leading to the knowledge of the truth. And they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. This is where you are. Maybe, surely, almost every one of us here, if it's not you, you know someone who is in this place. As much as you talk to them, they just don't see what you're talking about. They don't think that they're captive. But they're held captive by the enemy. They're in the snare of the devil. And they need to hear this truth from you, not in a quarrelsome way, but in a loving, gentle way. They need to hear this truth. And God will open their eyes prayerfully and lead them to repentance. This is the only way that they'll ever repent, is as he opens their eyes. But perhaps part of opening those eyes is you hearing this today. For the person or persons who may be hearing this for the first time, that you are in captivity. You have been in bondage to your sin. We have all been in bondage to our sin. And the only difference between you and me is that I have understood that Jesus has set me free. And many of the people here have understood that Jesus has set them free. And maybe, just maybe, God has called you here today for you to understand that Jesus will set you free. Just surrender. Just surrender to that. Surrender to that great gift. That great gift of freedom from your sin. Freedom from the wages of sin, which is death, in and only in Jesus Christ. Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. Sing it differently when you sing it from here on out, knowing the depth of theology, the depth of Scripture, and the depth of what it means to you. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you give us your Scriptures, that your Scripture is alive. No matter how old it is, it's alive. And it speaks to us, it works in our lives, it cuts through to the truth of who we are. It opens our eyes to the truth of who we are. God, I pray that many, if not all of the people here today that understand ourselves to be free in Christ, God, that we worship you, we celebrate you as a result of that reality that you've placed us in, that we celebrate, God, and have confidence in your second coming, because we can look at the long expectedness of the Old Testament and see that it came to be in the New Testament with the first coming. And God, we can have the same confidence, trust, and faith that what your New Testament tells us will come again, that Jesus will come again. We can trust it and believe it, and that we live into that. We live into and unto that, Father. I pray that it informs our thinking, informs our biblical perspective on life. I pray, Father, if anyone has heard this today or later down the road and understands themselves to be, up to this point, held captive to their sin, I pray, Father, that they will surrender to your offer, accept your offer of freedom in Jesus Christ, announce it to the world, follow you in baptism. God, I pray that people would do that and do that abundantly. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.